Here's something that's really cool, and I think that's really exciting. I think that you'll be excited about it too. Why do we use energy, and what is the advantage of using it? You can use energy to replace some of those kinematics equations that I showed you. You'll actually find that it's easier to do things using energy and looking at the world through energy if you don't have to deal with a pesky thing like time. Let's try a pretty basic problem. Let's talk about dropping a ball from a height h. And I'm gonna figure out what the velocity is going over here, okay? Here's what I can do. I can take a look at how high this thing is, and I'm gonna use old school kinematics equations. I'm gonna do it pretty quickly, so try to keep up. I would say that the equation I would wanna use is delta x equals v naught t plus 1/2 at squared. You guys remember and know and love this equation. My velocity initial is zero. My acceleration is g, and my delta x is h. So h is equal to 1/2 g t squared. So my, actually, I'm sorry, that's not the equation I want to use. Is that the equation I want to use? All right, fine, yeah. All right, I'll use that equation. So my, my time that it takes is 2h equals gt squared. So t is equal to 2h over g with the square root over. But that's not what I was asked to solve for. I was asked to figure out what the velocity is. So now that I have my time that it takes to hit the ground, I can solve the velocity by plugging it into v equals v naught plus at, v naught was zero. So I just basically multiply this by g, and I end up getting v equals g times the square root of 2h over g. I can make this the square root of g squared, the square root of 2h over g. And then I can make this v equals the square root of 2gh. Are we cool with that? This is old school. This is like, hey, remember this that we did? All right, good. Why don't I write that answer down over here? V equals the square root of 2gh. Okay? Now I'm going to approach this problem with using energy and talking about energy. What type of energy does the ball have when it's up here? What type of energy? There's three. There's potential energy. Now you have to be specific, and I know it's kind of obvious here, but is this gravitational potential energy or spring potential energy? Yeah, exactly. It needs to be, yeah, PEG. It's the gravitational potential energy. So what I'm going to introduce you is this concept of energy is conserved. All of the energy you have in is equal to all of the energy that comes out of the system. So what kind of energy is at the beginning of the system? That's potential energy. Is there any kinetic energy in the beginning? No. So it's not moving.
Okay,
there.
And
that's going to equal to all of my potential energy in the end plus all the kinetic energy. How much potential energy does it have at h equals 0 over here? Well, if the equation for potential energy is mgh and h equals 0, then it has no potential energy. Right? So where did all that energy come from? Well, it came from, or where did all that energy go? It went into moving the ball, so it has kinetic energy down here. I'm looking at two different pictures. At the beginning, it has potential energy. At the end, it has kinetic energy. Potential energy is mgh. Kinetic energy is 1/2 mv squared. I want to solve for v, figure out what that is. M cancels with m. Multiply this up by 2, so 2gh equals v squared. Square root both sides. Square root of 2gh equals v. You want to see something cool? That's the same equation. You can look at these kinds of problems with the energy glasses on as opposed to the kinematics glasses on. The disadvantage is when you look at things with energy, there is no time. in this equation. So if I ask you for to find how long does it take, then you'll have to be forced to go back to those old school kinematics equations. But if I'm asking you, like, how fast is it going, then you can use these things. Now, here's the thing that makes it really cool. I'm going to kind of tie it all together. You can actually do problems using energy that you can't do using kinematics. For example, and this is where it becomes relevant. Say I have a pendulum, all right? You know what a pendulum is. You put it up here, it swings back and forth. My question to you is, how do I figure out how fast it's moving right here? I know the length of my pendulum is L, and I know the angle that I moved it at is at theta. How do I figure out how fast it's moving right here? Okay, what you do is this. I set up my energy equations. I do the conservation of energy. Maybe the easiest way to write that would be PE plus KE equals PE plus KE. And I put a little I here, F here, and F here. That stands for the potential energy initial plus the kinetic energy initial is equal to the potential energy final plus the kinetic energy final. It's saying all the energy added up in the beginning is equal to all the energy added up in the end. And if I had a spring in here somewhere, I would throw in the potential energy with a little S on the bottom of it. Does that make sense? So I'm adding up all the energy in the beginning and adding up all the energy in the end. My question to you is, how much energy do I have in the beginning? What kind of energy do I have at this point right here? I have potential energy. Do I have kinetic energy? So what I do is I put a little zero right here. I just cross it out, put a little zero. In the end, do I have potential energy? When the ball is down here? No? Right. I don't have any potential energy, but I have kinetic energy. So I have this equation, mgh is equal to 1/2 mv squared. The masses cancel. That's interesting. I move this 2 up here. Take the square root of both sides. So I have V equals the square root of 2gh. Here's the hard part. Here's the little trick. But it's really a little trick. Is I don't have the height at which I dropped it. How high above this point did I drop it at? What is the vertical distance between the initial point and the final point? But you can find that using basic trigonometry. I mean, I could ask you this question on an SAT. You would know that the distance between here and here is L, right? Here to here is the length L. You know that the distance from here to here, if you look at this triangle, is L cosine theta. Do you agree? So the height that I'm looking for is this distance from here to here. It's the whole length L minus L cosine theta. So instead of writing an H, I'm going to have V is equal to the square root of 2G times L minus L cosine theta. That's the trick with the pendulums, but the pendulum's a pretty simple trick. What are your thoughts, vomits, questions, etc.? All right, cool. Why don't we do this now?